Hi everyone, Bruno here. Welcome to my series on This and That. In this episode, we'll be talking about the career of Al Neri, the character in The Godfather. I'll be making reference to The Godfather book by Mario Puzo, the classic bestseller. Most of it will be from chapter 30 of the book. Although not a main character in The Godfather trilogy, Al Neri plays a crucial role as Michael's bodyguard and enforcer, and essentially a replacement of Luca Brasi. In the book, it explains how Al Neri was to Michael Corleone what Luca Brasi was to Vito Corleone. He was his replacement. He played a vital and a crucial role in the Corleone crime family. It's interesting, as although a vital element to the Corleone crime family, Al Neri is mostly an overlooked character. And that is most likely due to his secondary role in the trilogy. In Godfather 1, Al Neri doesn't even have any dialogue. However, he does have an impressive career, and that will be the topic of this episode. We'll touch on his career as a police officer, and then also get into his career in the Corleone crime family. We'll also touch on his marriage to Rita, as it is pivotal to understanding his entry into the underworld. Al Neri as a police officer. In the space of 5 years, Neri became one of the most feared policemen on the New York City force. He employed a physical strength that was truly extraordinary, which he himself did not fully appreciate. Neri usually carried his favorite weapon, a huge flashlight. His face, when he was angry, was so brutally menacing, combined with his uniform, that the usual punks were cowed. Neri was transferred to the beat that held the United Nations building area, mainly because he had not shown his precinct sergeant the proper respect. The United Nations people, with their diplomatic immunity, parked their limousines all over the streets without regard to police regulations. Neri made complaints about this, but was told to ignore it. So one day, Neri took his huge flashlight from the patrol car and went down the street smashing windshields to smithereens, and he did this for a week. It eventually led to Albert Neri being transferred to Harlem. An event that takes place in Harlem would eventually set off a spiral of other events that would lead to Al Neri's introduction to the underworld. But before we get to this event that happened in Harlem, we will talk about Al Neri's marriage to Rita Neri. Al Neri's marriage. Al Neri had married Rita when she was a high school kid and he was a rookie policeman. She was shy, dark-haired, from a straight-laced Italian family, but an event that took place at Al Neri's sister's place would change all that, where her love for Neri would turn into fear of him. One Sunday, Neri took his wife to visit his widowed sister in Brooklyn. His nephew Tommy had come in very late Saturday night and was still sleeping in his room. When he woke, he went and asked his mother where dinner was. When she replied that there was no dinner and that he should wake up earlier, he swore at her and just said that he'll go and eat out. As soon as Tommy said this, he regretted it. His Uncle Al was on him like a cat on a mouse. Not so much for the insult to his sister that this particular day, but because it was obvious that he often talked to his mother in such a fashion when they were alone. Neri gave his nephew a merciless, careful, physical beating. At first, the youth made an attempt at self-defense, but soon gave up and begged for mercy. Neri slapped his face until the lips were swollen and bloody. He rocked the kid's head back and slammed him against the wall. He punched him in the stomach, then got him prone on the carpet and slapped his face into the carpet. The two women were frightened at the sight of this. It was 2 months after this that Al Neri got back from a late shift on the force and found his wife had left him. She had packed all her clothes and gone back to her family. Her father told him that Rita was afraid of him, that she was afraid to live with him because of his temper. Al was stunned with this. He had never struck his wife, never threatened her in any way, had never felt anything but affection for her. It was unfortunate that the next night he ran into trouble on his shift. His car answered a call in Harlem, a report of a deadly assault. We'll now discuss this a bit further, as this is the event that ultimately sets off a spiral of events that leads Al Neri into the underworld. The Harlem Incident. There was a crowd gathered outside a tenement doorway. One woman said to Neri, "There's a man in there cutting a little girl." Neri went into the hallway, and he went into the room, and there he saw a man called Wax Baines, a notorious pimp, dope pusher, and strong-arm artist. Neri tried to arrest Wax, but was attacked by him with his knife. So, in response, Neri swung out his flashlight in a short, vicious arc. The knife dropped from his hand. He was quite helpless, so Neri's second blow was inexcusable. Wax died 2 hours later in the Harlem hospital. Neri's second blow was deemed inexcusable, as the police departmental hearing and his criminal trial later proved with the help of a testimony of witnesses and his fellow policemen. He was indicted for manslaughter, convicted, and sentenced to from 1 to 10 years in prison. Neri did not fear prison. He felt that because of being a policeman, and especially because of the nature of his offense, he would be well taken care of. Only his wife's father, a shrewd old-style Italian who owned a fish market in the Bronx, realized that a man like Albert Neri had little chance of surviving a year in prison. One of his fellow inmates might kill him. If not, he was almost certain to kill one of them. Out of guilt that his daughter had deserted a fine husband for some womanly foolishness, Neri's father-in-law used his contacts with the Corleone family. The Corleone family knew about Albert Neri. He was something of a legend as a legitimately tough cop. He had made a certain reputation as a man not to be held lightly. Introduction to the Corleone crime family. The Corleone family was always interested in such men. The fact that he was a policeman did not mean too much. Many young men started down a false path to their true destiny. It was Pete Clemenza who brought the Neri affair to Tom Hagen's attention. He said, "Maybe we have another Luca Brasi here." After Tom Hagen and Michael Corleone looked into him, Al Neri was informed that the judge had reconsidered his case on the basis of new information and affidavits submitted by high police officials. His sentence was suspended and he was released. Neri learned what had happened and paid his debt to the father-in-law by agreeing to divorce from Rita. Then he made a trip out to Long Beach to thank his benefactor. Arrangements had been made beforehand. Michael received him in his library. Michael offered him a job out in Vegas for Neri to head up security there in one of the hotels. He was also invited for lunch with the Corleone family. After a good talk, Neri was struck by the thought that he was finally with his own true people. He understood that he was only a casual guest, but he knew that he could find a permanent place and be happy in such a world. The Corleone family valued him. Society did not. He did not want to work in Vegas, but he would take a job with the family in New York. He made his loyalty clear. Before he could actually set up to work with the family in New York, Michael insisted that Neri take a vacation down in Miami at the family hotel there. After his vacation, he was put in the Clemenza regime. Certain precautions had to be taken. He had, after all, once been a policeman. Clemenza sang his praises. Neri was a wonder, the new Luca Brasi. It was confirmed. The Don explains to Michael the following. Luca Brasi was such a man, but he was such an extraordinary man that for a long time nobody could kill him. Most of these people have no concern to ourselves, but a Brasi is a powerful weapon to be used. The trick is that since he does not fear death, and indeed looks for it, then the trick is to make yourself the only person in the world that he truly desires not to kill him. He has only that one fear, not of death, but that you may be the one to kill him. He is yours then. Mo Greene and Emilio Barzini assassinations. Al Neri earned the trust of the Corleone family. He was entrusted with such important projects, those of assassinating Mo Greene and Emilio Barzini. And in The Godfather Part 2, the movie, he was even entrusted with the assassination of Fredo Corleone. He was sent out west as a representative of the Corleone family for a funeral of a family friend, a Hollywood actor, Nino Valenti. 2 days after Nino's funeral, Mo Greene was shot to death in the Hollywood home of his movie star mistress. Albert Neri did not reappear in New York until almost a month later. He had taken a vacation in the Caribbean and returned to duty, tanned almost black. Michael Corleone welcomed him with a smile and a few words of praise, which included the information that Neri would from then on receive an extra living, the family income, from an East Side book considered especially rich. Neri was content, satisfied that he lived in a world that properly rewarded a man who did his duty. Michael Corleone had absolute trust in Albert Neri, so he was also entrusted with the important task of taking out Emilio Barzini. Dressed in his police uniform and pretending to write a summons to the limo driver, Neri took out Emilio Barzini and successfully completed his project. After the victory of the Corleone family in the Five Families War, and after a year of delicate political maneuvering established Michael Corleone as the most powerful family chief in the United States, Albert Neri was transferred to Nevada, where he was head of all security for the family-controlled hotels. Although in the movie, Al Neri is a looked-over character and has a quiet role, in the book, you can see that he had quite an interesting career. I find it quite interesting how he started off as a policeman, but then was a feared member of one of the most powerful crime families in New York. It really just shows how life can really take you anywhere. And while you might plan for things, you never know what can come out and where life might lead you. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed this video. As mentioned, most of the information in this video about Albert Neri comes from Mario Puzo's The Godfather, Chapter 30. Okay, that's it from me now. Leave your comments below. All the best, and talk soon.